that you will see when Divya will present that it started with studying something many will think of useless research, blue sky research, or wasting government's money. Why should we study bacterial immunity? Like, why should we try to understand how bacteria protect itself from viral infection, the bacteria-specific virus called the bacteriophages? But you should know, and you already may know, that the entire biotechnology tool called restriction enzymes came out of this study only. That that is one kind of immunity mechanism of bacteria that has heavily benefited molecular biology and biotechnology per se. And then the other one is, you know, what Divya will talk about today, CRISPR-Cas mechanism. This started with completely blue sky research, trying to understand how certain bacteria are immune to bacteriophage infection. And if you would want, I'll give you a third example. Here is a challenge for you, that try to find the original papers where scientists were trying to understand the physiology of bacteria that were residing in the hot springs of Yellowstone National Park. When they were doing that, you can be rest assured that none of them had in their mind that this line of research eventually will uncover or lead to establishment of a tool that is indispensable today, which is like a PCR, polymerase chain reaction. You all know the rest of the story. So today's presentation will highlight this one aspect, that how basic science research is not at all divorced from applied research. In fact, they go hand in hand. And then you will see that if you look into the career track record of Jennifer Doudna or the other Nobel laureate, you all know that they both got Nobel laureate Nobel Prizes 3 weeks back. They are out and out card-carrying basic scientists. But what they did is they simply knew the literature well, and they realized that the mechanism that is being worked on by other people can be harnessed to do something new in biotechnology. And the other part that Divya will highlight for you is that how this technology is being adopted left, right, and center for all sorts of processes, you know, when it comes to more advanced form of mouse genetics. Certainly, you know that in China already they have CRISPR technologies, and there is a promise that CRISPR-Cas technology holds in human health and disease treatment. So it's a whole new area that has opened up in last 8 to 10 years, you know, and the massive, massive accelerated scale of development that you were looking at. While from the original discovery to the first hint of biotechnology took more than 20 years, but the subsequent development happened rapidly. So Divya will also therefore explain to you the scope of applications of this CRISPR-Cas technology. And I hope that you will enjoy it. Divya will share the slides with you, and you know, like you should consider it as part of your course. And you will be, you know, I'm confident that from Divya's presentation today, you will learn about CRISPR-Cas technology, and which will allow you to follow research papers, think about your own experiments in a particular manner, and all sorts of other benefits. Okay, so with that introduction, let me request Divya to share the screen and start her presentation.
Can you all see my screen?
Yeah.
As sir just said, this the CRISPR-Cas system is very relevant
currently. Divya, microphone आपके नजदीक लाना पड़ेगा. और if you are using laptop, you may want to disconnect the earphone. It will be without the earphone. It will be much better. Perhaps we can try that.
Is it better now?
No.
Okay.
Is it better now?
Much better.
Okay. So, today I'll be talking about what the CRISPR-Cas system is, what it does, how it functions, and how we can utilize it for applications such as gene editing. So, the CRISPR-Cas system is found in prokaryotes. And if you look at their DNA, you'll find some characteristic elements in this CRISPR locus. So in this figure here, I've shown an example of a type of a CRISPR-Cas system. So you would notice that there's a sequence of Cas genes. These Cas genes are organized in an operon system, and they are called the Cas operon. And if you look upstream of the Cas operon, there is the tracker gene. Now, this gene, when transcribed, produces the trans-activating CRISPR RNA or the tracker RNA. And it is, we'll see how important it is in the functioning of this system. And downstream of the Cas operon is the CRISPR array. Now here, you can see some white boxes. These represent the repeat sequences. Now the name CRISPR, clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats. So these are the short palindromic repeats in the CRISPR array. And they're interspersed by some unique sequences called the spacers. Now, when the sequences of the spacers were compared to the available sequence banks, they found that they were not some random new sequences produced. Rather, they were derived from pre-existing sequences. And more importantly, these sequences were mainly from phages and plasmids. Now, we'll see the significance of this finding a little later. But first, now based on the variety, the types of Cas genes that are present in a particular CRISPR locus, and the mechanism of action of it, the CRISPR-Cas systems are classified into three types, the type 1, type 2, and type 3. So what does this system really do? We just saw that the spacers are derived from phages and plasmids. It was also observed that these sequences of the spacers corresponded to genes which were involved in various types of bacterial infection. And if we inactivated any of these genes, it would be enough to prevent infection of the bacteria by these phages. Another observation was that there was a negative correlation between the number of spacers in a CRISPR locus and the sensitivity of that particular bacterial strain to phage infection. So if you have a higher number of spacers in the CRISPR locus, then you would be less likely to be infected by phages. These observations suggest that there is some sort of a link between immunity of bacteria against phages and the CRISPR and the spacers in the CRISPR locus. So to confirm this hypothesis, many experiments were conducted. I'll discuss a few results with you. One was that when phage-resistant mutants of bacteria were naturally generated from phage-sensitive bacteria, it was observed that there was always a change in the number of spacers. And when a spacer was removed from a phage-resistant strain, it made the strain sensitive to that to the corresponding phage. And to check the converse of this, when they added a spacer corresponding to a new phage to which the bacteria was not resistant to, they found that in most cases, phage resistance was observed, but there were a few cases where it wasn't. So from this, one can conclude that spacers are necessary for phage resistance, but they are not sufficient. So what else is involved in this process of phage resistance? It is the Cas genes, which we saw were in the operon system right upstream of the CRISPR array where the spacers were present. Now, there was a very high correlation between the Cas genes and the CRISPR array across many species. That means that the presence of the Cas genes and the CRISPR array so close to each other could not have happened simply by chance, statistically speaking. So this indicates that there must be some sort of a functional coupling between the two. To confirm this, there were experiments conducted and they inactivated some Cas genes, and they found that there could be two possible outcomes. One was that the bacterial strain lost resistance to phages, and the other was that the strain lost the ability to generate new novel phage resistance against new phages. So from that, we can conclude that Cas genes are involved in phage resistance and spacer acquisition. So we just looked at what the function of the CRISPR-Cas system is. How does it achieve this function? What is the mechanism of working? The mechanism can be broken down into three broad steps, three broad phases: the adaptive phase, the expression phase, and the interference phase. So the adaptive phase happens when the bacterium is infected by the phage for the first time. So the foreign genetic material that is inserted, that is called the protospacer. This term would be used a lot in the next slides. So this protospacer, a part of this protospacer is integrated in the CRISPR locus in the bacteria, and the part that is integrated is called the spacer. And it was observed that this acquisition of a new spacer always happens at the first position in the CRISPR array, and that position is the leader end. Now, during subsequent infections of the same phage, the expression phase and the interference phases occur. So during the expression phase, the CRISPR array is transcribed to give the precursor CRISPR RNA or the, and this pre-CR RNA is matured, is processed to give mature CR RNA.
Divya, sorry to interrupt you. You may want to pause, once in a while to ask the class if they have any questions.
Okay.
Because it's a new topic for them. If you call the questioning at the end, they may forget.
Yes. If anyone has any questions, please stop me in between if I forget to stop myself.
Yeah, I have one question.
Okay.
You have mentioned that in adaptive phase, the bacteriophages which did not infect any bacteria previously, and the those say some sequences of the bacteriophage gets inserted into the CRISPR array, right?
Mm-hmm.
So is there any specific sequence of the phages that get integrated into the CRISPR array, or any of the sequences of the phage genome can get integrated into the CRISPR array? Is there any specificity of the fudge sequence?
It's the genes that are involved in the infection that are usually integrated in the CRISPR array. Because later, these particular spaces that are integrated, these are the ones that are used to interfere with the corresponding, this same sequence in the phage. So that, and if you want to stop the infection, you need to target the genes that are involved in the infection. So it's okay. The genes that are involved in infection.
Okay, okay. Thank you.
So during the interference phase, the matured crRNA, it interferes with the foreign DNA or the mRNA that it produces through various mechanisms, which we'll see in the upcoming slides. Now, we saw that there were three types of CRISPR-Cas systems. If you look at the mechanisms of these different types, you'll see that the type 1 and the type 3 of the systems, they have a mechanism of action which is very similar to the siRNA mechanism, which is an RNA interference mechanism. So it targets the mRNA that is produced from the foreign DNA. And the type 2 mechanism is it targets the foreign DNA that is inserted, not the mRNA. And it's the type 2 mechanism which is used for gene editing purposes, mainly because it's because we want to cleave DNA usually, and it's a much simpler mechanism. It has much fewer components involved. So let's first look at the mechanism of the type 1 and type 3 systems. So if you see the figure over here, this is the CRISPR array, which is transcribed into the pre-crRNA. And this is processed through multiple steps to give mature crRNA. And these mature crRNAs, they form a complex with many Cas proteins. The Cas proteins are produced from the Cas genes in the Cas operon. And during the, for the maturation, again, Cas genes are involved, which function as endonucleases. So they cleave the primary, the pre-crRNA into shorter strands. And this, so the mature crRNA, it forms a complex with multiple Cas proteins. And this complex is called the RNA-induced silencing complex, or the RISC. This binds to the target mRNA. And this happens through complementarity. Now, since the primary, this mature crRNA has some parts of the spacers, and these sequences are identical to the mRNA that the phage produces. So they bind through complementarity, and the proteins in the RISC, they cleave the RNA at that position. Just to compare the two systems, the siRNA mechanism and this RNA interference mechanism, I've put a flowchart of the siRNA mechanism on the left side. So here you can see that the double-stranded or duplex RNA, it's processed by a protein called the dicer. And this matured RNA, duplex RNA, it forms a complex with some proteins called the RISC. And this complex, it degrades one strand of the duplex RNA, and the other strand, remaining strand, is used to pair through base pairing to the target DNA, target mRNA. And the proteins in the RISC, they cleave the mRNA and silence it. Now, similarly here, you can see that the pre-crRNA is mature, is processed by some Cas proteins into mature crRNA, and here it's only a single strand, so there is no degradation after the formation of the complex. And so this complex again anneals to the mRNA target, and it cleaves the mRNA at a particular position. Are there any questions? Okay, so moving on to the type 2 system. Now, remember here the target is not an mRNA, it's the foreign DNA that has been injected into the cell. So if we had seen in the first slide that there is a tracker RNA right upstream of the Cas operon. Now this tracker RNA is this gene is transcribed to give the tracker RNA, the transactivating crRNA. And the speciality of this RNA is that it is complementary to the repeat regions of the pre-crRNA. So the pre-crRNA is transcribed from the whole CRISPR array, and the CRISPR array had repeat sequences and the spacer sequences. So the tracker RNA is complementary to the repeat regions. So this tracker RNA goes in pairs, base pairs with the pre-crRNA.
So Divya, the repeat region that is specific for a particular bacteria?
It's a highly conserved repeat, and it's specific to that particular CRISPR system, that locus.
So in a particular bacteria, can there be multiple CRISPR systems?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Multiple of the same type or of different types.
And they may have their own signature repeat sequences.
Yes. Okay.
Divya.
Yes.
It's not an issue. Can you go back to the visuals of the tracker RNA and the one where it is base pairing? It's a bit difficult to visualize.
Are you talking about this slide or?
Yeah. So where is this base pairing? Like with what is this tracker RNA base pairing?
Okay, so this is the gene for the tracker RNA, and when this is transcribed, it produces the tracker RNA, the transcript. Now, the sequence of this is such that it is complementary to these white boxes, which represent the repeats in the CRISPR array. So when the CRISPR array is also transcribed to give the pre-crRNA, the tracker RNA can go in pair with the pre-crRNA at the repeat region. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. All right.
Okay. So once they are paired, they are co-processed by the enzyme RNase-3, which is present in the host. And all of this happens in the presence of a Cas protein called the Cas9 protein. Now, here, it has been observed that this maturation process, it cannot happen if either the Cas9 protein is missing or if the pre-crRNA and the tracker RNA cannot pair for some reason. So the tracker RNA, in a way, it triggers the co-processing by the RNase-3. And Cas9 is the only Cas protein that is used in the interference and the expression phases in the type 2 systems. That's why it has very few components and is quite ideal to be used for other applications. So what is the role of Cas9 here? Why is it required for this processing? The Cas9 protein, it acts as a molecular anchor. So it helps base pair the tracker RNA and the pre-crRNA. And since this is necessary to trigger the processing by the RNase 3, we need the Cas9 for this process to begin. And another function that the Cas9 protein plays is that it protects both of these RNAs against other RNA digesting enzymes that may be present in the host. So now this was the expression phase. So we process the pre-CR RNA to give the mature CR RNA. Now we move on to the interference phase. Now for this, successfully interfere with a protospacer, the protospacer was the invading phage or plasmid, right? So this protospacer, it must have a short conserved sequence. It is called the protospacer associated motif, or the PAM. If this PAM is not present in the invading sequence, then there won't be any interference, even if the spacer and the protospacer are identical. So if the PAM sequence is not present, there won't be any interference. Now, what the mature CR RNA and the tracker RNA and the Cas9 protein, these three components, they form a complex called the Cas9 CR RNA complex. And this complex goes and binds to the protospacer and it cleaves it. And there's a type 2 system, so they are targeting the DNA sequence, not the mRNA produced from the protospacer. How does the complex cut the target DNA? So the CR RNA, the mature CR RNA, it came from the CRISPR array, which had spacers complementary to the target protospacer. So the CR RNA also has those complementary sequences. So the CR RNA can bind to the target, and if the target is a double-stranded DNA, then when the CR RNA binds to the complementary strand, I'll just go to the next slide, which has a diagram. So here, over here is the target protospacer. This is the CR RNA, and this is the tracker RNA. As I mentioned before, the tracker RNA has complementarity to the repeat regions in the CR RNA. So the tracker RNA binds to that through base pairing. And now the spacer region over here, this can bind to the complementary strand of the target double-stranded DNA. Now, since this strand, some part of this strand is bound to the CR RNA, it cannot bind to the non-complementary strand of the target. So there's a strand separation over here, and this is called the R loop formation. So the CR RNA and the tracker RNA, which are in the complex with the Cas9, they bind in such a way that the tracker RNA is bound to the repeat region of the CR RNA, and the spacer part of the CR RNA is bound to the target DNA. And this causes strand separation and R loop formation. Now the Cas9 protein, it has two active sites, the RUVC and the HNH active site. Now these two act as nucleases, so they can cleave DNA. So the Cas9 positions itself such that each active site is positioned on either of the strands of the target double-stranded DNA. And they work in a coordinated way and create a cut at both these sites, which results in a double-strand break and a blunt-ended DNA. And this double-strand break always happens at three nucleotides upstream of the PAM sequence, which, if you remember, needs to be present on the protospacer, otherwise there won't be any interference. So now you may ask two questions. How does this Cas9 CR RNA complex know where the target, which DNA is the target DNA? How does it recognize the target? And the other, how does it go and bind to it? Now, for recognizing the target, it depends on the Cas9 protein is guided by these two RNAs, CRRNA and TrkRRNA. It does not need anything else to recognize the target DNA. And the TrkRRNA, it pairs with the repeat sequence of the CRRNA. And this triggers the CRRNA to to cleave the target DNA that it is bound to. And for binding, because the TrkRRNA binds to the repeat part of the CRRNA, it orients it in such a way that the rest of the portion can interact with the target DNA. And this allows for binding. So the CRRNA and the TrkRRNA, they have to form this sort of a secondary structure. They have to anneal. And without the formation of this particular structure, there won't be any binding. And therefore, there won't be any cleavage. And so there won't be any interference.
So Divya, Promit raised hand.
Yes, sir. So in that base pairing diagram, can you just go back? So does this base pairing between the CRRNA and the target DNA, does it have to be a perfect base pairing every time?
Yes, it has to be a perfect base pairing.
Okay.
In this diagram,
this diagram, while you are at this slide, also show me, can you show where is the PAM sequence here? Or it is not in the diagram?
It hasn't been highlighted here. It's a three nucleotide sequence.
Okay.
So I don't really know which one it is here.
Okay. And in the TrkRRNA, where you have this blue highlighted base paired region, you see there is a discontinuity between this 4AW and then there is a gap and then there is CGAU. So this this GAA is not complementary, so it is bulging out. It's not really a gap. Okay, fine. Okay, I got it.
And so this highlighted blue portion, that is the that has been found out through different experiments. And that is the minimum sequence of the CRRNA and the TrkRRNA required for guiding this Cas9 for cleavage and for binding and cleavage.
Okay.
So just to summarize everything that we've seen in this type 2 system. So in the we're focusing here only on the expression and the interference phases. And in these two phases, the major steps were first the pre-CRRNA that has been transcribed from the CRISPR array that has to be processed to give mature CRRNA. Then this mature CRRNA that forms a complex with the Cas9 and the TrkRRNA, the Cas9 CRRNA complex. And this complex then binds, it recognizes and binds to the complement, to the target. And with the help of the Cas9, the target is cleaved. So what are the components involved in every step? For the first step, for the maturation, first the Cas9 protein, it helps in the base pairing of the TrkRRNA and the pre-CRRNA. And this triggers the co-processing through the RNase-3, which is present in the host. And then the CRRNA, the TrkRRNA and Cas9, they join to form the Cas9 CRRNA complex. And the TrkRRNA and the CRRNA, they form a secondary structure. This orients the CRRNA so that it can bind, recognize and bind to the target DNA. And the target DNA must have a PAM. It has also been found that if the target DNA is only a single-stranded DNA, not a double-stranded, then it does not need the PAM sequence. And I'll come to why that that is so in the next slide. The Cas, the complex is now bound to the target, and with the help of the Cas9, the target is cleaved at 3 nucleotides upstream of the PAM sequence. So if you look at each component involved here and what all functions it does. So the Cas9, it was involved first in the base in helping the base pairing of the tracker and pre-CR RNA. It protects the RNAs from degradation, and in the last cleavage step, it catalyzes the cleavage of the target DNA. The CRRNA is required for base pairing with the target, and it also base pairs with the tracker RNA, which allows for binding and the cleavage of the target. The tracker RNA, it triggers the co-processing of the pre-CRRNA and the tracker RNA, and it forms the secondary structure with the CRRNA, which helps in binding to the target, and it also activates the cleavage of the target DNA by the Cas9 protein. Now the PAM sequence, it is required for unwinding the duplex to make the open R loop structure. That's why it's not required if the target DNA is a single stranded DNA, because we don't need an R loop. We don't need to separate any strands over there. Then the RNase 3, processes the pre-CR RNA and the tracker RNA. So are there any doubts in this mechanism?
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes.
So this Cas9 protein, is it specific for a pair of CRRNA and tracker RNA, or it's the same protein for all the different pairs?
No, it's the same protein.
Okay. I have one question.
Yes.
What triggers this expression of Cas proteins and the transcription of different pre-CR RNA and the tracker RNA? I mean, is it a general transcription, or there is some specific transcription factors are present that triggers this expression?
The expression of these is triggered when there is infection. So it's not it's a specific transcription.
Yeah. I actually wanted to know if there is any transcription factor present or not. Let's take a bacteria is infected by a phage, and then how the further downstream signaling goes on.
I haven't studied that part. So if we can somehow make let's say we want to cleave a particular DNA sequence at some position. So if we can make a tracker RNA, a CRRNA, complementary to that sequence, and we can provide the Cas9 and the host the RNase 3, then theoretically we should be able to cleave that target DNA. So that's what was tried by Dudna and Emmanuel Charpentier, and this is what won them the Nobel Prize. They designed a chimeric RNA. So in this picture, you can see they have the yellow and red part is the CRRNA, and the 3' end of the CRRNA is connected to the 5' end of this tracker RNA through a loop. And so they made two types of these chimeric RNAs. One had some extra 5 to 12 nucleotides after the minimum nucleotides required for the tracker RNA to paste to pair with GCR RNA, and the other was shorter. It had very few nucleotides here. So as you can see, this
Divya, just a suggestion. Just temporarily, you know, you have that diagram where you showed the base pairing of tracker RNA, crRNA, the double-stranded DNA. Yeah, just copy this diagram.
Okay.
Just like escape, copy. Then go to the number 15 slide, paste it, and move it little up or down, whatever, so that you can show what was the innovation here. The innovation here is simple, right? That they got the tracker RNA and crRNA into one DNA construct.
Yes.
Like, see, like in the mechanism slide, you had these two as two separate molecules. The crRNA sp2 and the tracker RNA below that are two different things. Here, artificially, you have created a very small construct, but that creates that secondary structure because of the complementarity built in, and that will be the tool with which you will be editing the DNA, right?
Yes.
So that's what is the small leap, but it's a giant step forward in using it as a biotechnology tool. If the class did not understand, please spend some time looking at it and thinking about it.
Should I move on to the next slide, or should I wait for a little more time?
No, if there are no questions, then you can delete this thing and move on.
Okay. So here in this figure, on the top, you can see the what happens in the bacterial cell. The tracker RNA is bound. It has some sort of a loop here. Like you can see over at the left end, there is a loop structure, and that's seen here. And the tracker RNA binds to the crRNA, and the crRNA is bound to the target. And this is what happens when we use a chimeric RNA. So the structure is quite similar. That's why they had hoped that it would work. So this single transcript, it mimics the dual RNA structure that is found in the system. What they found through different various cleavage assays was that the longer of the two types of chimeric RNAs used, the longer one was able to guide the cleavage of the target DNA. But the shorter one did not work as efficiently. So that shows that the extra nucleotides over here, these are required for proper binding and cleavage of the target. Now, all of this was done in vitro, not inside a cell. So, and there were other experiments which repeated this inside prokaryotic cells.
Hello?
And they found.
Hello, Dibya?
Yes.
Can you just go back?
Yes.
So, what is the significance of the formation of this loop in the tracer RNA?
It helps with the. Orienting the crRNA that it is bound so that the crRNA can further bind to the target. It plays some role in binding to the target DNA.
So in the programmed in the RNA, it is not present there.
Yeah, it was not present in the shorter version, but in the longer one, there was some sort of a secondary structure which allowed for the long for a more efficient cleavage.
Divya, I wanted to ask a question.
Yes.
This 20 nucleotide sequence that is shown, which is a chimeric sequence, which is binding to the double strand where the loop is forming. So whatever DNA sequence we want to cut, we have to engineer these 20 nucleotide sequences.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you.
And Divya, perhaps you should emphasize that the double-stranded DNA, that the region you choose to edit has to be carefully chosen because of this presence of PAM sequence has to be a major criteria.
Yes, yes. Since the target here is a double-stranded DNA, we need a PAM sequence to be there because it helps in separating the loops so that there can be cleavage. Without that, so we need to make the target such that there is a PAM sequence.
I have a question as well.
Yes.
So these spacer sequences are actually unique to, or you must say that complementary to the phage that is actually infecting the bacteria, and the bacteria later gains these sequences in the genome, right? Complementary to the phage that is infecting. So how exactly are these sequences integrated into the genome of bacteria? Are they, the phage genome is actually integrating into the genome, or is there any other mechanism by which it is gaining?
I have a different slide prepared. I did not include it here, but maybe after this I can go into that, or I can send it to you.
Okay, sure.
The way I understand it, when you were talking about genome editing, you are no longer worried about the phage sequences.
Yes.
Like these crRNA, tracker RNA, all these are the same terminology that is being used, but now it's a completely artificial system. Like you decide any stretch of DNA in eukaryotes that you want to engineer, you have to select that sequence based on proximity to a PAM sequence. The three nucleotide PAM signature is presumed to be the same as it is in bacteria. And then whatever sequence you choose, you design a chimeric, like you design a DNA construct where you will have a part that is like if you go to the lower diagram on your right, that will be complementary to one strand. And then the extension of the transcript from that artificial DNA will have a stem loop structure and an extended like this red region, which is hanging out a little bit. So you are utilizing the phage bacteria mechanism, but here you have nothing of that system other than the Cas9 protein. That is the only system coming originally from the bacteria. Everything else is completely artificial. If I am, Dibya, please correct me if I am wrong.
Yes, you're right, sir.
Yes, sir. But actually, I was wondering about what exactly happens in the natural system, how bacteria is gaining immunity against the phage that is infecting.
You're asking about the adaptive phase where the new spacers are acquired.
So, the spacers get incorporated? Okay.
Yes. I was wondering if the phage DNA is integrating into the genome, or by some other mechanism it is gaining the complementary sequences to the phage DNA, or maybe the genetic material, whatever phage has.
I'll send a link to that paper with these slides.
Okay, sure.
So all of this was done in vitro with simply these components are made to interact to produce this effect. And this was also tried in prokaryotic cells. And they established that the expression of tracker RNA, the pre-CR RNA, the host RNase-3, and the Cas9. So these four components were necessary and sufficient for this cleavage, either in vitro or in prokaryotic cells. Now, humans or any other eukaryotes, they don't have this CRISPR-Cas system. So they are, if we were to introduce this system into them, they would act as heterologous hosts. So that is what they did next. They tried to introduce this system into the human into a human cell line and see if it could produce cleavage of a particular target sequence. So for this, they constructed each component such that it works well, it is compatible with the human cell line. So for Cas9 and RNase3, they took the genes from a bacteria and they attached it to they attached a nuclear localization signal to it so that after expression it would go straight to the nucleus, because the target DNA here, which we want to cleave, is inside the nucleus. And we used a particular promoter here, and we transfected these through separate expression vectors. And for crRNA and tracker RNA, they made it such that it targets the a particular 30 base pair site in the human EMX1 locus, which is in the human chromosome in the cell. And again, use separate vectors to transfect into the cell. Now, they transfected different combinations of the components, and they observed that the efficient cleavage was observed even without transfecting the RNase3. So that shows that only three components are required, because somehow the RNase3 is being used from the host cell, even in the heterologous hosts. So you only need to give the pre-CR RNA, the tracker RNA, and the Cas9 gene. And so now to check how generalizable this method of gene editing is, they targeted more than one site in the human cell, and they did this through a single tracker RNA and a single crRNA. So they basically put more spacers in the crRNA and the tracker RNA. And parallelly, just for a comparison, they used the chimeric crRNA tracker RNA method that we discussed just before this. And what they observed was that there was cleavage in all of the sites, not just one, in all of the target sites that were present in the crRNA and the tracker RNA, that were corresponding to these spacers in the crRNA and the tracker RNA. So this points to the possibility of multiplex genome engineering. So you can use a single array and you can cleave multiple positions at the same time. When they compared the chimeric RNA method and this method, they found that the efficiency of the chimeric RNA was very, very low or even undetectable. So this is clearly a better method for gene editing. And there are many hypothesized reasons for this. One is that the stability of these chimeric RNAs was not good enough. And they might have been degraded by some sort of an RNA interference machinery, like the siRNA system, miRNA system. The chimeric RNAs could have formed some secondary structures which prevented them from loading efficiently onto the Cas9 or to recognize the target efficiently. So from here, we have seen that these three components, the tracker RNA, crRNA, and the Cas9 genes, when they are transfected into a heterologous host, they can produce efficient cleavage of the of multiple targets at a time. And this is a much, much more efficient technique than the chimeric RNA method. Are there any questions? So I have cited all the papers that most of the papers that I've read, and if you are interested, you can go through them. I've cited these last two papers in these slides, and it would be great if you could go through them. Thank you.
So I have one question.
Yes.
Will you please share your slide again? I mean, yes. The screen.
Which slide?
Please go back to the slide where it showed the base pairing as well with the tracer and crRNA and DNA. With the bases, the previous one that this you copied.
This one.
Yeah, right. Since we can see that CRISPR RNA is actually binding to complementary DNA sequences and resulting in genome editing, I mean, why can't RNAi mechanism, we can utilize RNAi mechanism? I mean, what is the difference in genome editing and RNA interference in terms of how it is binding to DNA sequences and resulting in cleavage or...
Yeah. RNAi mechanism that targeted the mRNA, not the DNA, and we
right that I understand, but the basic mechanism is more or less same, like the maturation phase is same. Yes. Right, and here also RNA is binding to DNA and leading, so there must be some factor I did not understand or I did not find in the slide. Mm-hmm. That lets it bind to the DNA sequences and cleavage of DNA takes place. Whereas in RNAi, it simply binds to mRNA and results in either the degradation or the silencing of RNA.
I think it's the RISC complex that is formed over there that cannot cleave the DNA target. So even if it binds to a target DNA, the proteins cannot cleave the DNA. They can only cleave RNAs.
So if we provide Cas9 to the RNAi system and somehow we modulate it in a way that it bind the RNAi or the siRNA binds to DNA and then Cas9 functions, so do you think will it lead to genome editing as well?
The tracker RNA is not involved over there, so I don't know how efficient the binding would be. Over there, there's some RAM protein. There are other a lot of proteins involved in the binding to the target.
Okay. So yeah, that cannot might not use be elaborated same... in this talk, right? I understood.
Can you repeat that? I did not hear.
I mean, that might not be elaborated in this talk. So that is why that question popped in my mind.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, I have a question. Is my voice audible?
Yes.
This is a very good presentation, Divya. I just have a few questions. So in the beginning of the slide, like when you talked about the Cas operon, you had like mentioned Cas1, Cas2, and like other Cas proteins. So like, I would like to know, like, we know Cas9 is a DNA endonuclease. So Cas1, Cas2, and so on till Cas8. So like, what are those proteins
involved? These proteins are involved in the spacer acquisition, the adaptive phase.
Okay. And this RNase-3, which you had talked about, it is involved in what exactly?
Co-processing. It cleaves the pre-crRNA and it processes it into mature crRNA.
So this pre-crRNA is present in the CRISPR motif, I mean CRISPR locus of the bacteria.
The pre-CRRNA is the spacer array over here. This is okay. Transcribed to give the pre-CRRNA. That pre-CRRNA is processed.
Okay, so this region is called?
The array, the CRISPR array.
And this gives rise to the pre-CRRNA?
Yes.
And the pre-CRRNA is processed by RNase-3?
Yes. And for that processing, the tracker RNA must also bind to the pre-CRRNA.
Okay, so the processing will give what?
It gives a mature CRRNA, and that is what goes to the interference phase, and it forms the complex, and it binds to the target and further all the other.
Okay. Now I've understood. The third question is this, you have talked about this R loop. So I am not able to understand like what exactly it is. Is there a picture of it in your presentation? I think I must have.
I don't have a picture here, but basically these strands separate. Okay, wait, this part, they're separated here, right? So this loop is called the R loop in this sort of opening.
Okay. It is looking, is it looking like a letter R?
No.
I don't know
why it's called the R loop.
Okay. Fine. Okay. So last
maybe question. I can answer that regarding R loop.
Yes.
So it's actually a trihybrid structure between DNA and RNA and another single DNA strand. And if you see that, can you go to the previous slide? I mean, the slide where you have base pairing. Yeah. So these 20 nucleotides that they have mentioned, right, that is binding to the complementary strand of CRRNA. So that that is important here because I guess it is what would be happening is those are non-Watson binding, hydrogen binding. So that might be of importance in this case. So that area, this whole thing is called R loop.
Okay, so you're talking about this chimera?
No, not the chimera, the structure that is formed.
So the base pairing between...
It is the hybrid between DNA, RNA, and another single-stranded DNA.
So you're saying that all three of them...
The whole thing should be the R loop.
Okay. Fine. Okay, last question. After this double-stranded break is produced, we can either carry out this deletion, insertion, or like site-directed mutagen, right? How do we do that? Like, do we like supply DNA externally and then like to carry out?
Yes, just how you would insert any other piece of DNA. You use the different HDR mechanisms and everything that are already present in the cell, which will insert the DNA. If you create two cuts, then yes. I don't know if you've gone through that.
Okay, it's related to homology related.
Yes.
Repair. Okay. Fine. Thank you.
Divya, I have a question.
Yes.
So, what I wanted to ask is, like, after you've read all these papers and gone through the news and all, what do you think, in your opinion, is something that is hindering this technology reaching, like, humans and all? Like, we hear a lot of non-specific cutting and all of that, like, what I have come across. And also, there is something like I have heard that Cas13 systems are more efficient than Cas9 systems and all of that. So, where does all of that, the differences in specificity or and all, they come up? You are muted, actually.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
I have not studied about this Cas13 systems, but yes, there are other types of Cas systems found, and so I don't really know. I only read about type 1, 2, and 3
that systems. Gives me an opportunity to ask the class, Divya, if you take down your slide for a minute.
Yes.
Okay. Just a minute. So can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So this lady, Kimberly Cooper, she was mentioned in Jennifer Doudna's Nobel acceptance speech. I can try to see if she will be willing to give a teaching talk to us. Will you be interested?
Yes,
you can ask.
Yes, sir.
Definitely,
sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, so some of those more advanced questions you can ask Kim. And she will be able to give you answers. Okay, take it. So I will ask him. Let me see if she has the time. She is, of course, super busy, but I will ask. And of course, I will invite Divya for that talk. And Divya, you have really done a very good job. I am very impressed.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Anyone else has any other question?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, so I wanted to ask Divya, the sequence that you mentioned upstream of the tracer RNA and CRISPR RNA complex, the 5 to 12 nucleotide sequences, which like improve the efficiency. So is there any significance to what exactly nucleotides are used for them? In the, like when you are constructing a editing system? Hello, I actually are on mute, so I can't hear you.
Divya, you are on mute.
Yes, sir. Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Okay, so the loop structure that you see over here, the loop structure that is formed here, that cannot be formed if you have a shorter chimeric RNA. And this loop structure has been found to be very important for binding and recognition of the target site.
Okay. And another question about the SPAM sequence. So you mentioned NGG. Are there any other SPAM sequence which are present, or is that the only?
There are others too. I think it depends on the system that you're using.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any other questions?
Okay, if there are no other questions, then we should thank Divya and we'll meet again on Monday.
I have a small doubt.
Sure, Sandar.
The PAM sequence, it is a very short 3 nucleotide sequence, right? So this is why it is possible that in most of the sites, a 3 nucleotide sequence will be present, a conserved sequence will be present.
Yes.
And on that basis, we are doing all this.
Okay.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Are there any more questions?
Okay, for the final time, if there is no other question, let us thank Divya for doing a fantastic job. She did a favor to all of us, and we will meet again on Monday.
Thank you
for
the opportunity, sir.
Yes. Thank you, Divya.
Thank you, Divya. Hello. Bye, bye. Thank you all. Bye, bye.
Bye, sir.
Bye, sir.
Thank you, sir. Bye.